Our next presenter is Jeff Reuter, and Jeff is going to be talking about Lake Erie quality issues, and he's from OSU Sea Grant.
Thank you, Director Zeringer. I think I could have titled this talk, Haven't We Been Here Before? Because in the case of Lake Erie, we really have. We're back where we were in the 1970s. First, when you look at Lake Erie and the Great Lakes, it's important to recognize you're looking at the southernmost of the Great Lakes, and our watershed is very different than the other lakes. We're also the shallowest. The other lakes are all over 750 feet deep. Lake Superior, 1,333 feet deep. Deepest spot in Lake Erie, 210 feet in the Western Basin, only 24 feet. It's a very, very different system. And yet, all the water from the upper lakes eventually flows down through Lake Erie. Watersheds on those upper lakes, in fact, the watersheds on all the other lakes are dominated by forest ecosystems. The watershed around Lake Erie is dominated by an agricultural and an urban system. So if you start a concern about algal issues or harmful algal blooms and recognize that they require warm water, Lake Erie is the southernmost, the shallowest. It's going to be the warmest because we have the most agriculture around it and many cities around it. We're going to have the most nutrients. We are the most likely place to have these problems. Which basin is the most likely to have it? The Western Basin, because it's the shallowest, warmest, gets the most nutrients. So we get more sediment, more nutrients, more pesticides. All those things are going to be exacerbated by global warming and climate change. We'll talk about that in a second. Still, biologically, Lake Erie is most productive of the Great Lakes, producing more fish for human consumption than the other four combined. Lake Superior, 50% of the water, 2% of the fish. Lake Erie, 2% of the water, 50% of the fish. Very different systems. 80-10-10 rule, where's our water come from? 80% is coming in out of the Detroit River, 10% from the tributaries around the lake, 10% from direct precipitation. Some stats, we got drinking water for 11 million people at Lake Erie, over 20 power plants, 300 marinas just in Ohio, walleye capital of the world, 40% of all the charter boats on the Great Lakes. In fact, we have more charter boats in Ohio on Lake Erie than any other state in the country. $1.5 billion sport fishery, one of the top 10 sport fishing locations in the world, and the most valuable freshwater commercial fishery in the world. Some historical trends. We know the Cuyahoga River burned in 1969. The lake was getting worse every year easily up till 1970. Pretty much we stabilized things from 70 to 75. We could see improvement every year from 75 to 95, but it's also pretty easy for us to show the lake's been getting a little bit worse each year since 1995, and I'll show you some data on that in a second. Biggest problems or issues, it's not simply nutrient loading. Sedimentation is a big one. Phosphorus and nutrient loading, harmful algal blooms, aquatic invasive species, dead zone, climate change. Really, climate change is going to make all those things worse. Coastal economic development and energy production. I'm going to focus today just on the top ones. Essentially, if you look down at the lake, you get a sense of the amount of sediment coming in. Recognize there's a lot of nutrients that come in with that sediment. This is a typical spring. This is April this past year, but this actually happens every single spring. And when you look at the Great Lakes, there's no other place in the Great Lakes that looks like this. It's only the Western Basin of Lake Erie, and as you look to the north there you'll see Lake St. Clair, and the Thames River flows into Lake St. Clair right here. You can see that sediment trail down and come across the north shore of the lake, and the Thames River on the Canadian side also flows through primarily agricultural land. So nutrients and phosphorus, why do we get the most? Because we've got the most agriculture in the basin, our forests are gone, our wetlands are gone, and we've got a large human population with water treatment plants, septic tanks, and sewage treatment, or really lack thereof. So what brought about the rebirth? We think of Lake Erie with the dead lake images from the 1960s when the Cuyahoga River burned, but it's also the best example of the world of ecosystem recovery. And we brought that about going back to the 1970s by reducing the loading of phosphorus coming into the lake from 29,000 metric tons to 11,000 metric tons. And agriculture helped in that process. At that point, the primary source was point sources. We had very, very poor sewage treatment in the 70s. So two-thirds of the load coming in the 70s was coming from point sources. We improved sewage treatment, but agriculture also reduced their loading by about 50% at that time. This is back in the 1970s. This is my hand in front of Stone Lab. This is what Lake Erie looked like with the blooms in the 1970s. Also recognize that that particular bloom in the 70s was a Phanizomenon, same species that blooms in Grand Lake St. Mary's. Why are we targeting phosphorus? In fresh water, it's the limiting nutrient most frequently. Lake Erie concentrations have gotten so large right now that it's actually becoming less limiting, and we need to reduce it in order to control our harmful algal blooms. P reduction, or phosphorus reduction, is the best strategy ecologically and economically. However, reducing both phosphorus and nitrogen would help. Are we sure that the phosphorus reductions are going to solve our problem? We're exactly where we were in the 1970s, and it worked in the 1970s. We're 100% sure that it will. It's also important to recognize that in the 1970s, the reduction in the load that was required was a two-thirds reduction, from about 29,000 metric tons to 11,000 metric tons. This is a slide from Heidelberg showing a reduction that occurred in the concentration of soluble reactive phosphorus as we looked at total loading reductions from 1974 down to 1995. Remember how I stated that you could show Lake Erie getting a little bit worse each year? Until 1974, it improved, or 1970, it improved from 75 to 95. However, since 1995, you see that concentration going back up, and we're back up right now to where we were in the 1970s. It's important to note that if phosphorus concentrations are high, irregardless of the source, agriculture, sewage, whatever, if the phosphorus concentrations are high and the water's warm, we're going to have a harmful algal bloom. Nitrogen concentrations are likely going to determine which of the six or seven species that can bloom do bloom. But if the concentration of phosphorus is high, you're going to get one of those six or seven blooming. So as you look at the various points around the state, if you go into the western basin of Lake Erie, you can be pretty sure that the source of that phosphorus is primarily commercial fertilizer from agriculture. But if you go down into Burr Oak, I would speculate that we're probably looking at poor sewage treatment. And I think that's what you need to do, look at the individual source. It's also important that these high concentrations of phosphorus are not just going to form harmful algae, but you're going to see nuisance phosphorus. And this is what we see in the central basin of the lake in the Cleveland area, where water treatment plants are clogging with cladophora, a form that grows attached to things. And it contributes to the dead zone. It's primarily a western basin problem. Again, six to seven species can bloom. They're floaters. When they do bloom and it's very calm, you're going to see them floating at the surface. They're capable of producing four toxins. Microcystin is the one that we know the most about, and we don't know enough about that one. They require real high levels of nutrients, warm water. Some of them are nitrogen fixers, and they can cause human health and animal illnesses and death. Now, when we look at trends, not only are the trends in nutrient loading going in the wrong direction, but essentially if we look at concentrations of the toxin in the water, World Health Organization recommends 1 part per billion for drinking water, 20 parts per billion for swimming. The highest I'd seen up until this year in Lake Erie was 60 parts per billion. The highest we'd seen in Grand Lake St. Mary's up till last year was 84 parts per billion. But last year, Grand Lake St. Mary's went over 2,000. And then earlier this year, in the western basin of Lake Erie, we went over 1,200. So we're headed in the wrong direction. The trends are in the wrong direction. It's not just a Lake Erie and an Ohio problem, it's a global problem. We have the same thing in the tributaries to Lake Nipissing in Ontario. When we do workshops at Stone Laboratory to address this issue, the first workshop we did had people coming from Atlanta, Georgia, Madison, Wisconsin, regular calls from Texas and from Florida. So this is very much a world and national issue. Common species in Lake Erie is Microcystis, but the dominant form in Grand Lake St. Mary's in 2010 was a phanizomenon, and that's the same species that bloomed in Lake Erie in the 1970s. This is a typical bloom that you see. Gail showed this one earlier, but it comes predominantly out of the Maumee River and out of Sandusky Bay. And I'm going to show you, this is from about 2008, I believe, or earlier, 2003 even. This is also an important note. What you see right up here is the Open Lake Disposal site. That's Open Lake Disposal going on right there with approximately 850,000 cubic yards of sediment that was dredged from the Maumee River and is being Open Lake Disposed. This is what the Western Basin looked like in 2008. We know that these harmful algal blooms require warm water, but we're finding them in the Maumee River, or we're finding the species in the Maumee River as early as April. They need really high phosphorus concentrations. This is another slide from Heidelberg University, and let me put in a plug real quick here right now. One of the things that we're going to have as we move forward, Heidelberg probably has the premier water quality laboratory in the country when it comes to these kinds of tests and this kind of monitoring. And if we're going to address this issue, we're going to have to keep that water quality lab going and keep this monitoring program underway. The key thing right here, and this is again pointing at the bad trends, the blue line represents total loading from the Maumee River in 2010. That line set a record. But this year, that's the red line, we surpassed that load. So essentially, we're setting bad records each year. This is the slide that Gail showed. This is last summer in front of Stone Lab up at Put-in Bay. Sticking down in, what I want to point out right here is when I pulled my hand out of the water, if you look down there, you can see how I've like poked a hole in this stuff. When it's very calm, this stuff floats. You're going to see it at the surface. If you look under my hand, it looks clear under there. If we get a little bit of wave action, it's going to spread this stuff throughout the water column. Doesn't mean that we're not having a bloom, it's just not as evident. This is what the lake looked like this year, just last week. It's pretty light in here, so it's not showing up really well, but the bottom line is the bloom that we have this year mirrors that phosphorus loading. We set a record on phosphorus loading. We also set a record on microcystin concentration, the toxin concentration, and we set a record on the size of the bloom. And you can see that it's also now extending down into the Central Basin. This is what it looked like in the water. We put together a task force, actually a synthesis team, a group of scientists, 15 scientists from a dozen different universities, both sides of the border, U.S. and Canada, and agencies. Basically, we addressed this. I've got a few copies of the report here, not going to be able to go into details of that, but you can find the results of this work and the recommendations from that report on our website. There are about 18 different recommendations that you can pull out of the report and off the website for the Sea Grant program. Key points are back to some of the things that the Phosphorus Task Force had recommended, and that's incorporating the P into the soil. We can see that in some cases that results in greater than a 50% reduction in runoff. Preventing applications above agronomic needs, reducing fall application, eliminating application of phosphorus onto frozen and snow-covered ground, and consider getting soil tests for all of the fields. These are the things that would help tremendously. Along with this, these recommendations, we also put in some research needs, and one of the key research needs, I want to put in another plug for a speaker coming up later, and this will be Libby Dayton. We really need a lot more edge-of-field soil test work. Looking at the runoff and what that runoff is carrying. That's very important. These harmful algal blooms, because they float, they drift to the Central Basin. When they sink to the bottom in the Central Basin, they use up all the oxygen in the bottom waters. That contributes to the dead zone. This is a bloom drifting into the Central Basin in 2009. Same thing happened last year, and it's worse this year. We know that warm water favors these things, so if it gets warmer, and all the trends are that it's getting warmer, we're going to have more. Warm water increases oxygen depletion rates. More severe storms resuspend more sediment and increase erosion and nutrient loading. The critical important point here, if storms are worse and it's warmer, even if we had no changes in agricultural practices, we could still have a more significant problem because we're going to get more runoff from your unchanged practices. Lake levels are probably going down, and that's going to make things worse. The levers that you could potentially turn beyond the reductions that I talk about or the changes in agriculture would be eliminate open lake disposal of the harbor dredgings from the Maumee, eliminate orthophosphorus additions in water treatment plants, reduce sewage treatment plant phosphorus limits, improve septic systems, and eliminate combined sewer overflows. With that, I'll stop. Director Zimmerich.
Thanks, Jeff. Yeah. Thank you very much, Jeff. And as you can see, we certainly have our challenges, but the good news I take out of that, Jeff, is we can turn this around. And you know, your remarks on there's 11 million people getting drinking water out of Lake Erie. That's population of the state of Ohio. And I've said this many times before, we are all concerned about groups like HSUS and anti-livestock groups really hurting agriculture in the state of Ohio. We can convince people they have to eat. But when you impact the environment like this, this is a very, very difficult situation that we would have a hard time defending. So I am so glad that we have this group together, that we're going to grab the bull by the horns.